For our next keynote speaker, Professor Snyder, he oversees the Master of Divinity degree program in Buddhism and Interreligious Engagement, as well as the Thich Nhat Hanh program for Engaged Buddhism in Union Theological Seminary. Professor Snyder is an ordained Zen Buddhist priest and Dharma transmitted teacher in the lineage of Shinrin-ryu Suzuki. He co-founded and is currently the senior priest of the Brooklyn Zen Center, as well as the ancestral Har Zen Monastery in Milton, New York. Let's welcome. His topic today is chaplaincy Buddhist training in an interreligious world. Let's welcome Professor Snyder.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, CEO Lin, Dr. Herr, the Tsuchi Foundation for having me here, for the incredible hospitality we've received this week, which already points to one of the characteristics of a good chaplain. So thank you. I look forward to learning from all of you as we go through this, because care in our world right now is more critical than it ever has been, possibly. So I want to apologize because technology incompatibility has resulted in the slides animation not working, so these will be quite static. But I want to start by talking about, as we mentioned, chaplaincy and Buddhist training in the interreligious world, and I'll be focusing on the kind of internal training of a chaplain as we deal with it at Union when building the capacities to actually be able to do this. So as we know, we live in a complex, intersecting world. We're unconsciously relying on commonly held social and religious assumptions. Has not been an option for chaplains for some time. An inability to open across cultures and religions can harm and fail to provide the support we wish to give those who we serve. Union offers a microcosm. Union Theological Seminary offers a kind of microcosm, because we're having to train many people in different religions to work with in a multicultural space. We can't assume that our religious, moral, and cultural presumptions are appropriate for everyone we serve. Not only do others likely orient their beings by way of different religions, they also do so via varying experiences and expressions around race and caste and class, sex, gender, ability, and so on. If there is to be a stable, loving presence in service of others, chaplains must build capacities both to welcome radical and uncomfortable difference, as well as wisely discern within themselves habits of view and behavior that are barriers to inviting all fully into the heart of care. In this paper, the former, the paying attention to loving presence, I'll address through looking at the Brahmavihara, which I know Tsuchi teach, and as a frame for our affective presence, while the latter we'll look at in terms of karmic discernment. So, hold on. There we go. So looking at the Brahmavihara, I'll begin by addressing this as a framework for affective cultivation of chaplains. So as we know, it's metta, karuna, mudita, and upekkha. Translated here, the Brahmavihara set the stage for grounding human relationship in a deeply held, interconnected dignity and care. While each on its own might prove inadequate, the four Brahmavihara together support a whole relationship with another human being. As an example, let us consider, say, we're walking past someone who is economically impoverished and living in the street. This is unfortunately quite common in the United States. Committed to loving friendliness, we greet this person as we would our good friend, ensuring we smile from our heart as we pass, sending love with energy, bodily gesture, and presence. However, in this situation, as with many that chaplains will face, metta on its own risks being a shallow form of kindness if it does not fully acknowledge the suffering of the person before us. We then allow ourselves to feel the pain of the person's life, that they are vulnerable, without shelter, maybe unbathed, undernourished, unhealthy, without food, and possibly without family to care for them. This appropriately stabs at the heart, activating a caring wisdom. Feeling the suffering of this life, we act from karuna, Maybe we offer money, food, a shower, a place to stay, or begin to engage local city politics around care for the unhoused. However, even with metta and karuna, we have to further cultivate a recognition of full personhood. We must see the world from another's view, or we risk enacting condescending forms of care rooted in pity, compassion's near enemy. Mudita, or empathetic joy, protects us from pity. Through mudita, we take joyful account of the way this person arranges their limited belongings carefully into a home, no matter how precarious, and we care for their home with them. We inquire into their hopes, joys, aspirations, and meaning in their lives. Through mudita, we resist reducing human beings either to their suffering or to objects of our care. We embrace their full personhood, their perspective, their life, and we find our joy in their joy. Mudita protects us from condescending forms of compassion in the way that compassion protects us from shallow forms of love. Finally, upekkha, or equanimity, is the means by which we navigate the pain of caring for this world. If our minds and hearts are not trained as a calm foundation, relaxed with experience, we will be overwhelmed by suffering, overwhelmed by injustice, even by love and joy. Our life and our care will be off balance. Our care may interfere beyond what is skillful. Our sense of responsibility might mentally suffocate ourselves and others, exhausting our bodies to the point that we can no longer serve. Without equanimity, we can too easily become unskillful martyrs, allowing others to be in their personhood fully without our needing to become overly involved. Equanimity provides the wisdom and freedom necessary for the heart to dwell wisely with the other Brahma-Vihara. These four together are the ground of the chaplain's sustainable and skillful service. The scenario of the unhoused person translates to those who are sick, dying, imprisoned, suffering from poverty or a natural disaster, or otherwise distressed. In these intense situations, often we are not able to dwell in the Brahma-Vihara, and when we cannot, we risk our distress and lack of perspective, harming those we serve. The chaplain's responsibility, then, is to inquire into what hinders the ability to live from a skilled relational heart. What usually compromises our compassionate presence is, as we know, our self-attached views. Here, view is understood more deeply than just believed thoughts. Views are embedded karmic formations that orient our experienced worlds. The Brahma-Vihara are a litmus test for the degree to which we have worked through our unconscious orientations. If I cannot manifest a particular Brahma-Vihara, then I do the work of interrogating my views, intentions, and actions to see what hinders that expression. In other words, I become aware of my karma. I am doing something wrong. Hold on, here we go. Within Buddhism, karma refers to moral actions, usually categorized as wholesome and unwholesome. Those actions that harmonize and ease suffering versus those that separate and harm. For the Buddha, the pivotal determinant is cetana, or intentions. So it is not simply the action, for example, giving a gift that determines wholesome and unwholesome karma, but the intention behind it. Whether we're giving that gift from gratitude and love versus an attempt to manipulate the recipient for self-interested purposes. So in the Kama Sutta, the Buddha describes past and current karma in this way, and this is very important when thinking about a chaplain. And what, bhikkhus, is old karma? The eye is old karma, to be seen as generated and fashioned by volition, as something to be felt. The ear is old karma, the nose, tongue, body, the mind is old karma, to be seen as generated and fashioned by volition, our intention, as something to be felt. This is called old karma. And what bhikkhus is new karma? Whatever action one does now by body, speech, or mind, this is new karma. Here we see that past karma is found in our sensory and mental consciousnesses. Our past intentional behavior, what we do via body, speech, and mind, is embedded in the body, shaping and orienting the way we currently see, hear, touch, smell, feel, and think. While not everything that happens to us is due to past karma, the way we experience and respond to everything that happens to us is because of past karma. This insight is critical for anyone in service, as habitual views and actions are likely to be mostly unconscious orientations of the body and mind, limiting our experience and restricting our capacity to relate to others. As old karma is often unconscious, it is imperative that chaplaincy training make the sedimented intentionality of that's the old karma that's in our body conscious, so we might transform unwholesome karma and be aware of the limited nature of all karmic conditioning. Transformation of our conditioning will be facilitated by three things. Firstly, we accept ourselves as unconsciously conditioned and work not to treat our conditioned orientations as truths. Secondly, we require a cultivated equanimity and discernment that allows us to witness how conditioned behavior regenerates and affects ourselves and others. Finally, we need to consciously devote ourselves to wholesome mental orientations and behavior that counter unconscious, unwholesome conditioning. For example, a commitment to kind, truthful speech that counters habits of judgment and lying. The work here not only replaces unwholesome behavior with wholesome, but to release from all fixed forms of conditioned behavior, even wholesome behavior, if we are acting from self-interested intentions, can cause unintended harm for those we serve. Contextual flexibility, then, is as important as wholesome intentions. We consider self-inflating motives born of attachment to being a good person that can lurk behind compassionate actions and cause us to stumble into condescending forms of care. Non-attachment and wholesome intentions work together to release the chaplain from the missteps of grasping karmic orientations. One drawback, however, to karmic theory as a support for interreligious and multicultural chaplains is that the Buddhist tradition primarily focuses on the individual sage, which it alone can compromise our ability to see broader forms of shared social karma. To address this, I will turn briefly to the Yogacara school of Buddhism, which is most known for addressing the issue of collective karma. Yogacara thinkers had to explain why two different people experience roughly the same reality if past karma has shaped the very way each individually perceives. They broadly theorized that this is because groups of people, to greater or lesser degrees, are karmically conditioned in similar ways, which then results in the orientation of skandhas being shaped, our minds being shaped in like manner, thereby resulting in shared experiences. Arguing for this claim, Jessica Locke translates the 6th century Yogacaran Asvabhava to say, "Perceptions appear similarly to all who experience them through the force of maturation that is in accordance with their own collective karma." This issue here is that the more broadly past shared karma organizes current shared orientations, in other words, if we're all conditioned in similar ways, we're experiencing in similar ways, the more difficult then it is to see these orientations as what they are, which are group biases. The more that individuals are able to confirm their experiences of the world with others similarly conditioned as they are, with similar karma, the more they are likely to see those experiences as unconditioned permanent truths rather than karmically conditioned orientations. This in-group confirmation is what makes interreligious and multicultural work difficult, as each group feels confident in confirming their shared karmic orientations as truths, unable to see their perspectives as conditioned. Chaplains find themselves embedded in shared karmic orientations they are unable to see. This embedded karma can even make it difficult to recognize the needs or suffering of others. It is therefore imperative to have a process by which one can illuminate karmic orientations, both individual and shared. Toward this end, we will consider an early Buddhist framework for interrupted karmic cycles known as the Threefold Training, alongside a class offered at Union that supports the cultivation of alternative methodologies for witnessing and interrupting unconscious formation. So in the Dhammacakkappavattana Sutta, the sutta where the Buddha talks about the Four Noble Truths, he makes liberation from dukkha, often translating as suffering, the work of spiritual practice. After naming multiple expressions of dukkha, the Buddha summarizes its primary cause in the phrase, the five self-grasping skandhas or aggregates are dukkha. And these are the five skandhas: discerning consciousness, karmic formation, perception, sensation, and form. For the Buddhist tradition, these five make up the entirety of human experience. When referring to these aggregates, we are not merely naming the event or process of each one, but the way in which they sediment or aggregate in the mind as they come together in our experience. In other words, each one of these, each aggregate of human experience, is both entangled with the other ones, perception being entangled with sensation and so on, and with its own past impressions. So perception is entangled with past perceptions. They all layer on top of each other and affect the way that we currently see. Our experience, therefore, is shaped by historical conditioning. Mistaking our complex, swirling, interconnected, ever-changing, and highly historically dependent experience for an absolute truth, which is then grasped by us, results in dukkha. It also confuses a chaplain. In addition to this, the grasping of any aspect of experience, conscious or unconscious, is the foundational cause for karmic regeneration. So the seeing of experience as a karmically conditioned event is critical for our peace, our happiness, our freedom, our flexibility, and our relational skillfulness. Wisdom training. Fortunately, the sutta offers an intervention that over time results in freedom from dukkha. Known as the Threefold Training and Eightfold Path, it involves wisdom training, which includes right view and right intention, moral training, which includes right speech, action, and livelihood. You all know this as the Eightfold Path, and meditation training, which includes right effort, mindfulness, and concentration. While the Threefold Training is traditionally framed here as a means for ending suffering, it can also be understood as a methodology for interrupting, interrogating, and transforming karma. In the Introduction to Buddhist Meditation class at Union that trains chaplains, the Threefold Training is the underlying methodology for understanding how to engage chaplaincy. So wisdom training reshapes the residual karmic views and intentions through a commitment to dharmic views and intentions. Moral training reshapes unwholesome speech, action, and livelihood with devotion to wholesome expressions informed by precepts, vows, and moral practices. As actions can further entrench their foundational views, meditation training cultivates the mental effort, mindfulness, and concentration necessary to reshape and release from karma. The clearer and more stable the mind, the more deeply our old embodied karma can be felt, penetrated, clarified, and transformed. Our views, both conscious and unconscious orientations, are the foundations for correlated intentions, actions, and behaviors. They relate to each other. The intentions are built on the views, the actions built on the intentions, and then those actions reinscribe the views if they are unconscious. It is the wisdom training, moral training, mind training that brings the lotus forward, so this just doesn't happen unconsciously for us. The Buddha is quite brilliant in coming up with ways by which we can make these unconscious cycles conscious again. This is very relevant to chaplaincy. Our intentions accord with our views, our actions with intentions, and these intended actions are carried out. They further embed karmic orientations in the body to become old karma, thereby affecting the very way we see, hear, smell, and so on. The threefold training, however, supports us in seeing the conditioned cycle. The harmonization of the threefold training provides a foundation for four important aspects of chaplaincy work. Firstly, one develops a stable, informed, broad, attentive mind able to turn toward one's own habit patterns without falling out of relationship with others that we serve. The chaplain can concentrate both on taking moral responsibility for their own karmic inclinations as well as the person or situation they are serving. As such, the practitioner falls less into unconscious, self-attached views, having now the wisdom and freedom to turn their heart toward service. Secondly, once one manifests non-dual, wide, concentrated awareness through harmonization of these three trainings, the whole of experience can be included without the impulse to exclude what is difficult or uncomfortable. We are able to be still, open, and generative with a painful experience rather than compulsively turning away from it. Thirdly, once one has the experience of a stable mind, one can begin to see how unwholesome and unskillful behavior disrupt that stability. The cultivated mind and body become guideposts for moral and skillful behavior. Further, the chaplain is able to deeply sense into unwholesome forms of old karma held in the body. Finally, the foundations of the Brahmavihara are found here. If the mind is not trained to aim and sustain in an undivided presence, then the expression of any Brahmavihara is weakened. The practice of the Brahmavihara require effort, concentration, and mindfulness alongside of vigilance regarding one's own karmic hindrances. In turn, Brahmavihara address all aspects of the threefold training, requiring the renunciation of our grasped views, intentions, and moral actions, within a concentrated, wide presence of the heart that fully embraces oneself and others. While there are many teachings and practices within the Buddhist tradition that address each of these three trainings, it is important not to insist on Buddhist language and methods. Rather, we develop methods across traditions that support chaplains in cultivating capacities for compassionate presence alongside taking responsibility for their conditioning that hinders it. So regardless of the presence of taking responsibility for karma within the Buddhist tradition, all chaplains must do this regardless of tradition. So in service of this, we had to create a course at Union that addressed this kind of activity without being focused on Buddhism. While the Brahmavihara threefold training and karma can certainly underpin a methodology for chaplaincy training, Buddhist vocabulary may actually be limiting for some students. This being the case, we've had to find ways to support chaplains in creating methodologies for inquiry into karmic conditioning that do not rely on Buddhist practices. While not everyone is a Buddhist, the need for doing this, as we mentioned, is necessary. So we look at a course that we called the Practice of Self-Inquiry. In addressing the need for all Union students to become conscious of their personal and cultural biases, it became clear we needed to build a language and methodology that was open-ended and adaptive to a diverse group of future chaplains. The aim then could not be the delivery of a particular dharma or religious perspective, but rather the support of students in creating their own methodologies for discerning historical conditioning in order to become more aware of both personal and collective forms of embodied karmic orientations. The course syllabus draws on secular and religious thinkers from multiple traditions for the purpose of developing a methodology for inquiring into each student's own conditioning around self and identity. The course then had to create a methodological structure that guides the student while remaining open-ended enough to include diverse religious and cultural assumptions. The course methodology is organized in this way. So we start off, what is the self? For some traditions, they don't even ask this question. So introducing the question, what is the self? How does the student understand the self ontologically and experientially? Where is it experienced and what is the nature of what is being located? For many students, they never engage the question. Teleology, what is the purpose of your inquiry? Is it soteriological? Is it about salvation? Is it aimed at pure knowledge, moral betterment? How does their declared aim then affect their methodology for looking at themselves through which that aim is realized? How are aim and methodology connected? Suspension of a witness. Informed by a critical engagement with Edmund Husserl's articulation of epoché, by Zen master Ehe Dogen's backward step and other expressions of stabilizing a non-judgmental witness of experience, something we're familiar with in Buddhism, what does the student's mean for finding a stable witness vis-a-vis their own conditioned experience? Theory of body is a theory of perception. We all have ideas about what our body is, how we look at it, different traditions that inform us. Taking this language from the philosopher Merleau-Ponty, how does the student understand and experience their own body as it relates to the self and experience of a world? The way in which they experience their body has direct bearing on how they perceive the world around them. Confession and renunciation as a process of inquiry. All self-inquiry, in some fashion, requires a form of confession and renunciation in relationship to the aim of that self-inquiry. This is especially the case when morality is centered. For the student, is confession and renunciation then something that is morally normalizing? Is it cultivating some characteristic that they want to see happen? Is it liberatory in terms of liberating us from self-attachment, or is it some other kind of process? They have to come to understand this for themselves. The scene of address. This is a term borrowed from the work of a philosopher named Judith Butler. And what's being asked here is, who is being addressed in a self-inquiry process? For us, it might be our teacher, it might be bodhisattvas, the Buddha, it could be God, it could be any number of people, any number of beings. So, is it an imagined moral other? Is it a communal other? Is it our ancestors? Is it the earth? Is it non-human sentient beings? Here, students have to unpack their relationship to their own moral authority. Again, these are being positioned in such a way that they can be broad-reaching and adaptive to whatever the tradition. In some cases, these students don't necessarily identify with a religious tradition or moral tradition of any kind. So they're being encouraged to take this up. Epistemological method. Is the inquiry phenomenological? In other words, is it about our direct experience with regard to direct observations? Is it rational or logical in method? Does it rely on the imagination or some other method of knowing? How do you discern and articulate the difference as you shift from one means of knowing to another? Reliability of the inquiry. This is something we all struggle with. I'll go quickly here. How does one discern and account for the reliability of oneself as the witness, since we are all subject to resistance, self-deception, forgetfulness, and so on? How does one rely on others, spiritual community, elders, authority, as ways of addressing reliability? Responding to resistance. What are the practices that you use to respond to your own resistance and looking at your own conditioning? Social critique. If the I, and this is something interesting for all of us to consider, if the I is a function of norms and conditions, then self-inquiry includes engaging social conditioning and therefore becomes a form of social critique. How is this navigated with clarity? Where does moral responsibility lie? And then directly exposed being versus a narrated self. We all have an experience of a basic, intimate, experiential presence that we know in meditation, that we know in other forms of religious practice. But then there's also the narrated self, the story we tell about who we are, right? How do we understand these? How are they in relationship to each other? How do we inquire into them in their relationships? And how do they support presence in chaplaincy? So I'll just go quickly to the conclusion then here, which is the paper has attempted to highlight two broad aspects of chaplaincy training. Cultivating an undivided, compassionate presence, as well as taking responsibility for karmic conditioning that hinders that presence. Practical trainings in mature affective orientations toward others, the Brahma Vihara being an example, not only train the heart in caring presence, but provide a space where any limiting karmic orientations can be illuminated. However, it is also necessary to develop thorough methods for interrogating our conditioning, whether it is the threefold training, a course in self-inquiry, or otherwise, so that chaplains are fully supported in making conscious any unconscious embodied views, intentions, and actions that might limit providing skillful care for as many beings as possible in as many circumstances as possible. What is particularly important here is the way in which our shared collective karmic orientations might be invisible to us, thereby compromising chaplaincy work in interreligious and multicultural environments. In Mahayana Buddhism, we might refer to this non-grasping, non-dual, loving and compassionate orientation in response to suffering as bodhisattva activity. Here, we will simply refer to it as the work of a chaplain in an increasingly complex and distressed world. Thank you very, very much.